If you want to pump your body and expand your mind, there's only one place to go. Mind Pump. Mind Pump. With your hosts, Sal DiStefano, Adam Schaefer, and Justin Andrews.
In this episode of Mind Pump, for the first 27 minutes, Adam, Justin, and myself have some fun conversation. We talk about one of our favorite new shows on Netflix, Big Mouth.
Yeah.
It's all about hormones.
Oh, boy.
Horniness.
Super inappropriate.
Periods.
Fun.
All kinds of stuff.
Better caution. Yeah, exactly.
Super inappropriate.
Yeah, if you don't like, it's very South Park meets Simpsons meets...
Times 10.
Yeah, times Family 10. Guy mm-hmm. times, yeah, 10.
We also talk about some of the, some of the YouTube fitness stars that we met over the weekend. Quite interesting, you know, these people really understand how to use YouTube to communicate whatever information they're communicating. So some interesting stuff there. We talk about Thrive Market, our sponsor, and we actually order some stuff on air because we figured, hey, we get stuff from Thrive Market. Why not make Mind Pump Media, the company, pay for it?
Yeah, let's get it here.
So smart.
In the studio.
Now I get free stuff. By the way, if you go to thrivemarket.com/mindpump, here's what you'll get. Free shipping on $49 or more and $20 off the first three orders of $49 or more, plus 1 month free membership. Thrive Market likes Mind Pump so much, they basically said, we're going to hook up all your listeners like crazy. So that's what you get.
They're generous.
That's right. We also talk about our screwed up food supply. That'll freak you out a little bit. We talk about old time muscle building programming. It's an interesting conversation. Over the weekend, I was going over some old-time strongmen. Paul Anderson is one of them. And it's pretty fascinating how they trained. Very different from the way bodybuilders and stuff like to train today. Also, we mentioned Organifi, which is our other sponsor. Organifi makes organic supplements, protein powders, green juice, which is actually one of our favorite ones, believe it or not. That was the one we were most apprehensive of. And yet, that's the one we're drinking the most of every single day. If you go to OrganifiShop.com, enter the code MINDPUMP, you'll get 20% off pretty much anything. And then we get into the questions. The first question was, somebody's asking us what MAPS program would be best for a woman who just had a C-section. Yeah. So she's trying to get herself moving, starting to get back into shape. Which MAPS program would be best for somebody who just had a baby?
Lots of unqualified pregnancy advice right there.
From us.
Because we've been pregnant a bunch of times.
Right.
We're men.
How many pregnant? I've trained a lot.
Oh, I know. I have.
A lot.
And you've tried to get people pregnant many times.
Many, many times. Yes.
The next question was, what was our opinion on fish oil as a supplement for general health and well-being? Not as a beard oil, as Adam likes to use.
Find out if you should take
it
rectally.
That's why he smells.
The next question was, in a perfect world, what would our lives look like?
Sal's already perfect.
Yep, pretty much. Symmetrical face and everything.
More unicorns.
The last question was, we talk about meditation quite a bit on the show. How do we meditate? Like, how do we do it? Do we use apps? Do we use music?
I get away from you guys.
Is Justin failing at this?
Does he burn incense? Find out in this episode. Also,
I go,
you're in holiday season, which is great for family, great for connection, great for food.
Also excellent for getting fat.
Bad for your body.
Cookies.
Bad
average
for your body.
American puts on like 8 to 10 pounds over the next 3 months, bro.
Everybody gains body fat. Everybody gets
less
healthy.
Let's all calm down.
It's terrible. We look our worst typically around this time of year. So here's what you need to do. You need to enroll in the MAPS Super Bundle. So here's what the Super Bundle
gonna
includes.
Set you up for
get
all
a plan.
Year.
It includes our most popular MAPS programs, and it includes them in order so you can start from one, complete that MAPS program, move to the next one. Basically, you'll get a year of exercise. Expert exercise programming. What does that mean? Well, that means it's all planned out for you.
Yeah.
You know what to do this week. You know what exercises to do. You know what order to do them. You know how many reps. You know what your trigger sessions or focus sessions look like. And you have exercise demos in the program. So if you look at the exercise and it says, you know, MAPS Red Row, which is an exercise we invented, you can click on the link. It'll pull up the exercise. And there is handsome Justin demonstrating the movement for you. So it's all,
put my all into
it's as good as personal training or better, because most trainers suck, and it's way less expensive. It's a year's worth of exercise programming. Get started now before you start with your New Year's resolution so you can mitigate all that fat gain you're going to get from Thanksgiving and Christmas. You can get the MAP Super Bundle only one place. There's only one place you can get this. It's at mindpumpmedia.com.
Stay ahead of the chub.
And it's t-shirt time.
Let's give away some shirt. How many reviews are we getting here,
Doug?
Got
24.
Whoa.
Holy
shit. We've gone up.
Shiz niddle biddle.
You know what I think? I think a lot of these lovely ladies you've been talking to, Sal, are coming over.
Sal and his silver tongue.
I've been reaching out to a lot of these podcasts that have large female audiences because I think when they look at Mind Pump, you know, they see three dudes.
Look like a bunch of jabronis.
Yeah, and they think, oh, what are they going to talk about?
So we
about?
Send Sal in because he's the most feminine at all three of us. Yeah. Like, go
he's
over
got
there.
That touch.
Talk to the ladies. That, like, set it up.
Yes.
Get him over here.
Yeah. If you mean intelligent, yes.
Yeah. That's exactly what it means.
So we're going to give out 7 shirts this week.
Oh, shit. Hooking them up.
Yeah. So first up is Jonathan Fay, MD.
That's not a girl.
I like that guy.
Yeah. Could Sam be. Well, 25.
Could be a girl.
Mertzy, 16.
Probably a girl.
Mertzy.
JJ Youngs, DVMUFCV.
Hmm.
L. Bauer, 1. Hawk, Rob, and Don, 140. All of you are winners.
We got you guys.
Yeah, send a name I just read to iTunes at mindpumpmedia.com. Send your shirt size, your shipping address, and we'll get that right out to you.
Thanks, everybody.
How funny is that Big Mouth on you?
Oh, so good.
Have you guys got back and introduced your girls to it yet? Or what?
Oh, yeah. Me and my girl watching every episode. Yeah.
He's hilarious.
Dude, it's too much.
It's so inappropriate. It's great.
Yeah, it's so bad. It's good.
It's too much, dude. When the girl's hormone monster shows up because she's going through puberty and she gets all emotional and shit and she's talking about like the things that turn her on, and they include, like, sometimes I'm turned on by the clouds, and sometimes I'm turned on by a book, and my girl was cracking up. She's like, that's so true, dude, when you start going through that. And then she's, like, crying and freaking out and hates her mom all of a sudden. Fuck.
Yeah.
It's pretty damn good.
I don't want that to happen.
I was wondering if they nailed that side of it, too. That's why I had with Courtney watching it, you know, to see if, like, because I know the male side, it's like, it's so obvious.
They nailed
so
it.
The pillow, like, you know, like the guy banging the pillow and getting it pregnant. It's pretty classic.
It's a terrible classic. What are you talking about, Justin?
It's a classic move. Everybody's done it.
Justin's like, I've got at least 3 pillows pregnant. Yeah. He's like, I've had 3 pillows pregnant in my lifetime.
Hey, Justin.
Yeah,
it's not classic.
Just gotta get rid of them.
It's actually not that classic.
It's a classic move.
That's not.
I mean, it's been written
down. And then it's his brother. His brother did it with the pillow.
Oh yeah,
that's terrible.
You know, the first time I watched it, it's like one of those times where you almost feel guilty watching it because it's so raunchy and bad. I'm like, oh my god, this is fucking so inappropriate. And then after about the second one, I'm eased in. I'm like, this is great.
It makes me feel better about what we talk about. You know what I mean?
I think
so far.
That's comedy, dude. Comedy needs to be this way.
You got to stretch it out.
Mm-hmm.
No, I like when comedians and shows like that push boundaries. I think we're now in this society where everybody is so overly fucking sensitive, dude.
Oh, you're always looking over your shoulder before you even talk.
It drives me crazy, man. It's like, fuck, everybody's so sensitive, man. Relax.
Yeah.
Calm the fuck down, dude.
Wimps.
Yeah.
Wimps.
We're breeding all these pussies.
You're a bunch of wimps.
Be strong. Say inappropriate shit.
Man, the shit we used to go through when we were kids.
Yeah.
Oh, it's terrible.
Could you imagine being... We had this weekend where we had Connor and those guys in here. Could you imagine being that his age, that fit and good looking, and that much attention from girls and making that kind of money? That kid has got to be...
Yeah.
That's a hell of a time, I'm sure.
Well,
it's like you see Justin Bieber and those guys, like how they deal with it. Like, it's at a certain point when it gets to like ridiculous money and all that kind of stuff. Like, it just becomes like this weird, surreal reality.
I would love to talk to a girl or two
that has
dated him. Because what I think everybody who's obviously a huge fan, they all see this kind of facade, right? This guy that's like ultra confident. And he's the complete opposite of that, right?
In person.
Oh, yeah, in person, he's all quiet and
super reserved,
Yeah.
More of an introvert.
So I wonder how many, like, girls, like, think they're getting that guy, right? And then they meet him, and they're like, what the fuck?
But I can kind of identify with that a little bit as he was talking, because you know, there's something about that when you are in front of a camera or just like in front of a group of friends and you're trying to like entertain. It's a different operating system. Like,
oh, it definitely
for
plays
me,
in,
I definitely
it definitely plays that, into your that. Personality. I think you have the most in common, ironically.
I know, right? It's like totally not, but yeah. But as far as that aspect is concerned, I'm not introverted, but at the same time, I do have those types of. You know, I am reserved and listen a lot like to the group, but then if it's an entertainment, like I'm all in.
Right.
So yeah, it's interesting.
I have a tough time when I think I'm just entertaining. If I'm informing, I feel like I'm in my element. But when it's like, hey, go entertain, Sal.
Yeah.
Even I don't know what to do.
Even informing.
Let's talk about science.
Even informing to me is weird on the YouTube and the Insta story. It's just not. I'm so used to talking to humans. Uh-huh. Like, put me on a stage in front of hundreds of people, no big deal.
Yeah.
No big deal. Yeah. Room, tons of people I don't know, no big deal. Put me in front of a camera by myself, talking to just a camera, and all of a sudden it's like weird for me.
It is.
I have a really hard time.
Well, that's the first thing I noticed too with these kinds of characters that we're meeting. Like, they just, it becomes this extra thing that they're talking to. It's like easy and they navigate in it like, it becomes part of like, how they converse every day. It's like these people that they're talking to, you know, over the social media, it's like that's part of their everyday thing. And then you see how like easy and like fluid it is for them, because it's been, I'm sure it's been a lot of practice. But.
It comes to people naturally sometimes be able to do that.
Yeah.
Well, if I'm like talking and informing in front of a camera, it's not a problem at all. It's the whole entertaining thing that kind of throws me off.
Mm-hmm.
That's when we throw in Justin.
Throw in the cocktails.
Yeah, do some somersaults.
Hey, are we going to do some Thrive Market shopping right now?
Let's go.
Didn't we agree that this is how we're going to do this? Like, Dougie is going to shop for us, like, every week?
This is how we... So what we did was all of us were like, hey, Thrive Market, great prices on organic products. However, how can we also... not save even more money? And the way we decided to do this is make the company pay for it. So,
brilliant.
Welcome to Thrive Market segment on this Q&A episode. We're now on online at Thrive Market. So the first product I would like to order are the paleo pancake mix from Birch Benders.
Ooh.
Look that shit up.
Great choice.
They are delicious pancakes mix. And then they have another one that's gluten-free, which we'll take a look at. So you can see there's the protein pancake. Oh, they have a protein one. Look at that, Adam. That one's got whey in it, though. But look at that. $4.99 for 16-ounce.
I can have the whey. I'll take Doug. Okay, so if you're going to do that one, I'd like to try the whey one.
Okay, so you get one of those. And then let's look at... Hold on a second. Scroll
down
more.
That's only $4.99?
Yeah. Oh, you know what?
That's cheap.
For me, Doug, get me the gluten-free... pancake one, so it's one down, beep, right there, $4.79. It's cheaper than yours, Adam. Bro, you know how much that costs at the store for this pancake
like
mix?
$10-$12.
Yeah,
at least.
The cheapest I've seen it is like $7. Mm. So we got that. So what are you going to get, Justin?
I want to get some jerky.
Of course.
Yeah. I honestly, if I'm going to snack, it's either nuts or jerky. So it's one or the other. So let's look at the options for...
That's why your poop sticks to the toilet.
Why do so much
protein?
How come they don't have images for some?
I think it's because Doug's computer is slow.
I want the new Primal spicy grass fed jerky.
No, it's down, Doug.
Right there. $5.79 for a 2-ounce bag.
That sounds good.
Normally $7.59, 24% savings. Look at the Epic Mountain. If you go back, Doug.
That's a popular brand.
If you go back, you guys ever eat the Epic Mountain brand?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so look how much it costs right here. Watch. Ooh, look at Epic Bison Bacon with cran bars.
Hey, bro. $25.99. You already got your shit.
I'm just saying it out.
I know, right?
Relax. This guy. Like,
listen, he wants more. There's a lot of options here. I just went and chose that.
I got mine. You got yours. Justin just picked his.
You know what we need for the studio?
Yeah,
it's macadamia nuts.
Well, bro, slow down here, dude.
Let Adam go.
Slow down here.
Adam went already.
We already went. Sal already went. He's still going, though. Let Doug get his, and we're good to go.
Oh, yeah. What are you going
to
get, Doug?
This doesn't mean to be a 30-minute Thrive Market commercial.
You're right,
it just needs
right.
to be a fucking... already done
we take
it,
care of our sponsors.
I just want to get our shit. Let's rock and roll, man.
All right. Let's look. I want to see. Macadamia milk. $4.19. What do you do with the macadamia milk, by the way? You put it in cereal?
I don't really eat cereal as a general rule, but I'll use it in, say, a smoothie, for example, or just drink it. It's tasty.
I like macadamia nuts are my favorite nuts. How about you guys?
I like my own nuts.
Yeah.
Personally.
That's gross.
Well, if you're going to say my favorite.
I like almonds.
Salty.
No, I'm a little, yeah.
Pistachio. I'm a pistachio guy.
Are they the most, like, sprayed?
Almonds?
Yeah.
You got to go organic, dude.
Yeah. I know. Well, duh.
You want to know what's annoying?
Well,
here's what's annoying. I'm going to tell you guys straight up what's annoying. There's a difficult part to this job.
You're ruined already because you talked to fucking Dr. Minkoff already.
I talked to glyphosate.
God, I'm scared. Even organic, he's
wrong. Going to die.
Bro, I talked to Dr. Minkoff. I talked to Dr. Mercola. I talked to, who's the other guy I talked to? Dr. Bush. These are, by the way, these are legit doctors. They're not like just wellness experts. These are like board certified physicians. Dr. Bush in particular is a triple board certified doctor, done lots of research.
Which is
on
rare.
Cancer. Extremely rare, dude. Who the hell does that?
Yeah.
Crazy, right? He's crazy. You're crazy, Dr. Bush. But anyway.
You're crazy, man.
These are smart dudes and they're doing legit studies. So it's not just hearsay. They're doing actual trials and stuff like that. And they scare me because I hear all this stuff. I'm like, we're fucked, dude. Like,
well,
everything.
It is true. We are kind of fucked. But then there, and like, if you're a consumer, right, or you're a listener, like, how do you handle this? And I feel like we were talking about this in the car when we were listening to Dr. Minkoff before you had your interview with him. And, you know, I think what you have to do, the way you have to look at it, because I feel like there's two camps. There's either one, people that become very dogmatic about it, and they're like, oh my God, you had a Diet Pepsi, or oh my God, you had something that was unorganic. And then you have the other side that say, fuck it all. Yeah. Like, oh, it doesn't even really matter.
I'm not going to pay attention to anything.
I'm going to die when I die. I'm like, I'm going to enjoy my life. Well, it's like, well, how about we kind of live somewhere in the middle where we're
aware of everything.
Right.
But at the same time, we try constantly to make better choices, but we know that we're not like totally, totally optimal in everything.
See, the problem, what's happened is because people were unaware of these things, for the most part, because we didn't have studies supporting them. And then there's another small part in which the makers of these products and chemicals and stuff don't want bad information to come out. Obviously, they're trying to protect their product. They're trying to protect their market share. So because of that, there's never been any market pressures to push manufacturers to not use these chemicals or to not use, you know, these types of herbicides and pesticides and stuff like that. But now that consumers are becoming more aware, and, you know, hopefully we, through our show, help people become aware, but there's a lot more of shows that are happening right now talking about this, that it becomes now a factor when people go out and shop. And because it becomes a factor, it places more market pressures for manufacturers to eliminate some of these things and create, you know, products that, you know, we want, which, you know, now that we're learning some of the stuff, like, we don't want some of the stuff. It's the only reason why a company like Thrive Market would exist today, besides the fact that the internet makes it happen. Organifi, right? Organifi is a supplement company, our other sponsor. It's a supplement company that produces all organic supplements, and some of their supplements fall in the muscle building category, which didn't exist 6 years ago. 6 years ago, do you know how hard it was to find organic anything that had to do with muscle building?
Yeah.
You just didn't find it.
Super rare.
Super rare. Organic protein was super hard to find. You had to go to like special health food stores. If I went to GNC, it was all non-organic stuff.
I didn't even really see it till I saw that one campaign. It was like Save the Bros or whatever, and that sort of brought light to like bringing organics
into
the supplement.
Dude, that was such a great campaign.
Brilliant marketing.
One of the best campaigns ever.
Yeah. Don't know much about the company, but I know that was
Organic Valley,
campaign.
Right? It was Organic Valley who did that. What a brilliant campaign. Doug, my phone is all slow right now, but you guys just reminded me of something. I think we have a call with Thrive Market today, so make sure it's not around the time that we're doing this.
Sure, no problem.
They're listening right now.
Right. No, I know. I think we do have a call with them about future sponsorship and continuing on. So,
okay.
So let me make sure that before we go on a tangent on what's coming up here.
I didn't see anything for today. It says nothing on the schedule for today.
Okay, so we're good.
We're good.
We're okay.
It doesn't say that on Basecamp at least.
It must be tomorrow then, because I know we have it.
Didn't see it for tomorrow too. So let me ask
Katrina,
the boss, and we will find out. But anyhow. Yeah, I think if we, as people become more informed, it's going to place more market pressures, and then we'll see more and more. Because what's happened now is The problem is you have to make a conscious effort to seek these things out, because otherwise, by default, you're just exposing yourself to all the stuff, because that's what everything's made out of, all the products, everything, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's just crazy. The other thing too, one of the other things that Dr. Minkoff talked to me about was like aluminum foil. Like, don't use it. Mm. Don't cook with it. It literally.
What if you're trying to hide from the government? You know what I mean?
You put it on your head.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Like, there's a use for it.
They can't tap in your.
Saying. Is that why you wear the aluminum foil hat all the time?
Yeah, he wears aluminum helmet underwears.
Yeah, that too.
Yeah. So, but
it reflects all the negativity.
Here's the other thing I did this weekend. So I love going. God, I love the internet for so many different reasons. But one of the things I love to do is. It was very hard when I was a kid to find old school like muscle building information or manuals and stuff that like old school bodybuilders and strongmen used to write. Because believe it or not, they actually wrote manuals and stuff back in those days. Like, I'm talking about early 20th century stuff from some of these strongmen. They actually had manuals and stuff. It's just you couldn't find them before, because where would you find them? Now I can go online,
dude,
and I can find them. And
you brought that up, and I've been.
Did you start looking at?
Yeah, I've been going down.
How fucking rad is it?
It's so great. Yeah, to look at what their thought process was like, you know, leading into like their feats of strength. Like, how do I improve this? And some of their methods. And I saw like a lot of them used isometrics too, which was great.
Dude, here's the thing that that I love about looking back then. Back in those days, they didn't have, first off, there were no magazine cover, you know, sponsorships. Mm-hmm. There were no supplement sponsorships. There was no prize money to be won. Some of them became like circus strongmen or whatever. And otherwise, they just did it because they loved it. So it was truly a sport or an activity of passion. In fact, back then, it was weird to lift weights and want muscles, and where would you go anyway to lift them? So a lot of these guys made and fashioned their own weights and all that stuff. But besides that, obviously no anabolic steroids and no supplements. Supplements didn't exist back then. So their routines and their diet was completely designed around what worked.
Yeah.
It was all about what works with my body.
They were like technical wizards. You know,
they knew more about exercise.
Mechanics-wise and all that stuff.
They knew more about exercise than the bodybuilders and shit do today. Because I thought to myself, like, God, you know, I wonder if they were just not informed. But that's not true. These guys knew anatomy and they knew the body better.
I don't know if it's necessarily that. And I think it's that there's more people that don't know now because of all the misinformation. Yeah. Right? I think there's still categories and groups of people that do their homework, do their research, are diving deeper into the just being marketed and advertised to, I think. But then now, because it's become so popular, right? Because back in those days, it was such a small group. It's like what we see with kettlebell sport, such a small, tight community. That's what bodybuilding was like 20, 30 year, plus years ago. And so those guys all spoke to each other. It's like kettlebell sport. I guarantee most all of the big names know of the other big names, and they're all using similar type.
Same tours.
Right.
Circuit,
and they're using all the same tools to perform better because they're all communicating within these communities, where now fitness has exploded. It's so big and it's become commercialized that you have all these now camps of bullshit all over the place. And it's actually, and you know, this last weekend was a really good example of this, is that if you're entertaining, you're good looking, you're funny, you're charismatic, you're more likely
to become a fitness expert.
Right. Yeah. You become a fitness expert, and you're more likely to be heard than a guy like Chris Kresser or like a Rob Wolf, who are some of the most brilliant minds I've ever spoke to, but I would never have found these guys had it not been for the podcast world, right? So, you know, a lot of there is a lot of great information, even better information than what was back then, but it's just, it's harder to find. And I actually think this is going to be the struggle for the generations coming up. Yeah. And we've talked about this before with the confirmation bias. Like, if you all of a sudden get yourself, you know, in this lane of, I like these entertaining people, and then you're just going to get fed more of it. And then it's going to be that much harder for you to find the really good information.
Well, dude, it's like, because I was reading some of these guys, I was reading some of these guys' routine, and you guys know as well as I do that nobody did body part splits, or at least body part splits or the bro splits, were not common or popularized until much later, right? And body part splits didn't become popular until I think the mid to late 60s, early 70s, you know, Arnold's era is when they started doing body part splits. Before that, nobody did a split. Now, I thought to myself, I wonder if a split was just invented later. Like they came up with it later and then some. No, they tried splits back then too. They actually tried doing them and saying, I'm just going to work out my legs today. I'm just going to work out my arms today or whatever. And they all abandoned splits because they noticed they lost muscle and strength. And keep in mind, they were all natural.
Yeah.
There was no steroids back then. Even when they did start using steroids in the, like, you know, 50s and 60s. Well, 50s and 60s is when anabolic steroids started getting introduced.
Did they really that early?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so the 60s is when Dianabol started getting introduced. The 70s is when...
Which you could get it prescribed from your doctor back then.
You could.
You're actually right. I remember talking to a guy who was like, yeah, we could just walk down D-ball. And get some D-ball. Yeah.
What was it like Babe Ruth era? Like, they're fucking around with some like...
Amphetamines.
Okay.
Amphetamines. Amphetamines have been around for a long time. But yeah. But steroids, really the use of the steroids and part of cycles and stuff like that didn't happen until the late 60s, early 70s. And Arnold in that era really pioneered it. And then, of course, it's progressed since then. But... Even when they started taking steroids, do you know what they used to take? Do you know how much Larry Scott, the first Mr. Olympia, used to take?
Probably hardly anything.
Yeah.
5 milligrams to 10 milligrams of D-ball a day for maybe 4 weeks, 4 to 6 weeks.
Which now they take like 50 to 100.
On top of other stuff.
Well, yeah, yeah.
Because
yeah.
You figure, even if you took 10 milligrams, that's 70 total milligrams of steroids a week. Bodybuilders today would do more than that in a day.
Right, right.
Way more than that in a single day. It's right. Insane.
That's crazy.
So my point with that is the way that they trained, really the knowledge you'll get from those old school lifters is more applicable to the average person today, way more than the knowledge you're going to get from these guys that are taking all this gear and stuff who have nothing in common with you.
Well, I think they reached their pinnacle, right? They stretched as far as they could go as far as their programming, and they tried with their nutrition and everything, like, and then having that little bit of excess of testosterone made a humongous difference, because now it's like it's feeding into that already structured, like, optimal training situation.
Well, when you're taking that much gear, now you fall in a different category.
Your body doesn't, it's not working like a normal person.
Right, right. So you're not, there's nothing about what they're doing that you can compare if you're a natural person. And even somebody who's maybe not even 100% natural, like, it's just the amount of gear when you're taking grams of stuff you can get away with so much shit. I mean, you're super anabolic 24/7 all the time.
Do you guys, you got to, like, if you're listening right now and you're a fan of muscle building and stuff, you got to go back and look at some of the legends of yesteryear, because they were the lifts that they did were shocking. You guys know who Paul Anderson was? Mm-mm. Paul Anderson, one of the greatest American Olympic weightlifters of all time. This is a guy that competed in the 1950s, okay? And maybe he took something, maybe he didn't. He probably didn't take anything. So consider he was probably natural. The dude was 5'9 and a half, weighed 360 pounds. Cool. So he's a fucking horse. He goes up
5'9 and 360 pounds?
He was scary. His training regime consisted of, he used to lift in his barn.
I couldn't even process
He would
that,
go out to
yeah,
his...
Yeah, think about that. Okay, that makes Ben Pekulski look little.
Yeah.
Bro.
Think about that.
A thick, like, horse.
His legs were silly. And he used to lift. He would go compete in Olympic lifts in dress shoes, by the way. There's pictures of this guy.
I want to see a picture of this guy.
Okay. Paul Anderson. Look up Paul Anderson. So Paul Anderson, in 1955... It's a famous story. This is the height of the Cold War. The Soviets are, you know, they're kicking our ass. Paul Anderson walks up to the bar to do an overhead, you know, what is it? What was he doing? Overhead clean and press. 402 pounds. At that time, shattered world records. Nobody had ever seen him. Who's going to lift 400 pounds above their head? And he destroyed it.
Wow.
He crushed it.
Wow, he is a beast.
He was a crazy, crazy, crazy beast. Excuse me. So he did 402-pound overhead
Look
press.
Look at those weights on the squat. Mm-hmm. What? How much do you think one of those plates weighs?
I don't know, dude. I'm going to look up some of his best personal records.
Wow.
Clean and press, 408 pounds. He did that in 1955. He snatched 335. Clean and jerk, 440. This guy's just he did a back lift, which was a lift nobody does anymore. 6,270 pounds. You can look that up.
What?
Mm-hmm.
What is a back lift?
Look up the Paul Anderson back lift, Doug, so we can see what it looks like. He did a bench press raw, of course, and probably natural, 628 pounds, deadlifted 820 pounds, squatted raw at an exhibition, 1,200 pounds.
So is he just racked?
He's
on
just
his back like that with the weight.
I can't remember what a back lift was. I think he was like on hands and knees or something. I'm not quite sure, but you can see. You see, there you go. He's pulling up all these pictures of his his lifts.
Look at these weights. Look how weird they look.
Yeah. Yeah. Isn't that cool?
You know who he reminds me of is the guy that you started following. You tagged me in.
Oh, that dude Bud something.
Yeah,
on the,
yes.
So what's cool about this is if you read about his training methods, Paul Anderson would go in he had a barn, and he lived on a farm, and in between work or whatever, he'd go in the barn and he'd go in there with something like 2 gallons of whole milk, and he'd drink milk and squat all day. He'd just go in there and squat all day. And it was insane. That's, I think, a back lift right there.
What in the hell?
Yeah, it's like with your hands and knees, or you're on your hands and feet.
What the fuck? Yeah. What do you do there?
Anyway,
so dangerous.
The way,
it looks crazy, dude.
Anyway, the way that these guys trained all these old timers was lots of frequency. And none of them trained to failure. Paul Anderson talked about this. He never went to exhaustion. It was always this frequent training. They built tremendous amounts of muscle, size, strength, performance. And none of them followed these splits. And you know what's funny? I just read an article today, bodybuilding.com. I don't know if it was today that came out, but it came out recently. Jim Stepani, of all people, this whole article on why you should abandon the body part split and why you should train full body.
Our boy.
Dude. You know, when we first started Mind Pump almost 3 years ago, and we were on air and we talked about how body part splits are inferior to, you know, where you train the body more frequently. You can do full body or you can do other splits, but where you hit the body more frequently, we got laughed at. Everybody laughed. Everybody talked shit. And now you're starting to see this huge wave of people starting to figure it out.
Yeah.
It's pretty cool.
And what's cool about it, like what you're pointing out right now, we're not claiming that we created it.
No, dude. No,
it's not. Yeah. And I didn't find, this see, for me, that's not how I put it together. Like, I didn't go back. Like, you guys have this passion for the old strongman lifts. Like, I didn't even follow any of this old shit at all. What I started to notice was just my clients. Mm-hmm. I mean, because I've trained thousands of people. And when you start, you know, when I would put somebody on a full body routine and just hit them 2-3 times a week versus this splitting their body parts, they would just change rapidly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like, rapidly. And I wouldn't have to crush them in the gym. Like, I didn't have to like hammer a body part and then go to the next day, hammer another one. You would just, you know, do a few sets, move to the next exercise, a few more sets, move, and you do that every time.
Isn't it great?
Oh, yeah. And they would just respond.
Yeah,
so,
because the other, it's like, man, you hammer that body part so much, like it's you're dancing around that the entire workout. The next time you meet with them, it's like useless.
The only way that I see the body part split and where I kind of ran one is when I first competed. And at that time, dude, I'm training 7 days a week, and I'm still hitting each muscle group like 3 times a week.
That's the key. That's the key. It's the frequency. It's not even necessarily that a split is inferior. It's that
it makes it almost impossible to do 3 times a week.
Yeah, you got
to
hit the frequency.
Yeah, you
got to hit that frequency. That's the key. Really, is hitting, you know, because that muscle building signal, it peaks at about 72 hours post workout, and it's better for fat loss. It's better for strength. It's better for muscle building if you understand that and you maintain the anabolic signal and forget about beating the crap out of yourself and just getting, you know, just thinking about recovering. Mm-hmm. So anyway, I just want to throw that.
Bring on the bird!
This quaz brought to you by Organifi. For those days you fall short on getting your organic veggies or whole food nutrition, Organifi fills the gap with laboratory-tested, certified organic superfoods to help give your health and performance the added edge. Try Organifi totally risk-free for 60 days by going to Organifi.com. That's Organifi.com. And use the coupon code MINDPUMP for 20% off at checkout.
Our first question is from Mrs. D. Pasillas. What MAPS program would you recommend for a woman to follow after recovering from a C-section? She is currently suffering from some pregnancy complications and is not doing anything besides walking.
C-sections far more common today than they used to be. Mm. Far, far, far more common. This may be one of the reasons why birth weights seem to be climbing. Because more babies are born through C-section because they're bigger, whereas before you might not have been able to make it or whatever because the baby's too big. Could also be the mother's health and what she's eating. The other thing too is this, and it's starting to change, by the way. It wasn't that long ago that when you had a baby, you were on your back. laying in a bed with your legs up and you were just immobile.
Yeah.
We know now that that is far, it's inferior to being able to kind of squat down mm-hmm. and let gravity, number one, help out, and also the position of your pelvis. When a baby is traveling through the birth canal, that that posterior pelvic tilt's important to open that.
It's like a squatty potty.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, they design the beds now like that, where they're at like a 45-degree angle, and they have the feet up in the holsters like
it's
that.
It's better. Right? They've changed it, but it's recently.
Well, and it's interesting because I remember going through this part of it because we were looking at alternative ways, you know, to approach it, and that was one of those things, all the different positions that you could get into, like, you know, like a quadruped position, like a squat position, like all these different things to help kind of move the process along more effectively. It was interesting because
quadruped to do have a baby.
Yeah.
Oh, that would be unique.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Oh, that mm-hmm. would be really unique.
Yeah. I mean,
we had a doula, like, so this lady that was really helpful with all these types of things and like putting, using gravity to kind of help kind of move it along. And then also like avoid, you know, when it like the head turns and everything and, getting caught, you know, in certain sticky situations like that. So.
Certain sticky.
Very PC.
The other thing, too, is the
I watched the whole thing. Oh, my God.
The other thing, too, is the strength of the mother. The more fit you are going into, because let's be honest, having a baby, especially if you do it naturally, is one of the most difficult things you'll ever do in your entire life. It's akin to the hardest, you know, obstacle course race marathon you've ever done in terms of pure physical exhaustion. It's more difficult because it's way more risk, but I'm talking about just the physical exhaustion that goes with it. If you've ever, like, you know, Justin, you have two kids. I saw my ex-wife give birth to two. That's a long process of what do they call it? A game of attrition or whatever.
Yeah.
You just got to stick with it and it just takes a long time. So If you're planning on having a baby or you're pregnant or whatever, maintaining fitness makes a big difference
leading into it especially. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I mean, yeah, it's tough. It's a tough to recover from a C-section. I mean, you're cutting right through the abdominal.
Yeah, C-section. You're literally not only is the core weak and atrophied from most of the core, not all of it. The obliques actually maintain pretty good strength and stability, but the abdominal, but more so, even more than that, the TVA, the transverse abdominis,
TVA.
It's a muscle that goes around your core, and think of it like a corset. Like if you suck your stomach in right now, what you're activating is your TVA muscle. So that muscle, for obvious reasons, needs to stretch and atrophy or weaken in order to allow the baby to grow. It needs to make room. So it stretches out and it weakens. So that already is a problem, but on top of it, you had a baby and they had to give you a C-section, so now they've cut through all these muscles, so now they really have to be weak and atrophied because now you can't even, you know, just sneezing or coughing can be extremely painful right after a C-section. So when you are cleared to exercise, when the doctor says you're fine, you know, everything's healed, the key to start with is to strengthen that core stability before you do anything else, because otherwise you're going to rely heavily on
how aggressive would you go? Would you recommend like starting with prime and like pre-phase of red, or would you be aggressive and go to like a no BS six pack abs and like a program?
So it depends on the person. No BS six pack abs would be actually
too much, right?
You would be too aggressive,
right? Right.
Because that program is designed to like build the abs and build the core, so you can see
You need to build connection first.
She needs to build connection first. So
that recruitment.
I would say prime or prime pro, and then I would do. But I would even before that, I would just practice the vacuum poses, uh-huh.
which we have free on YouTube, right? So mm-hmm. there's a video that Sal did on the YouTube that's so if you do mind pump vacuum pose, it should pop right up for Sal.
Yeah, or even like on our wall test where you know you're manipulating your pelvic tilt.
Well, that's why I think the prime bundle would be the first thing that I would put her on, and then when she starts feeling good, because I mean that's all about intrinsically getting connected, right? So once she starts to progress with that, and I'd probably run that for 3 to 8 weeks, depending on depending on how well you're getting, you're moving, how strong you're starting to feel, and then from there I'd progress to probably MAPS Red. So I would start off in Prime and Pro, live in there, go to the YouTube, look at all the core exercises that we have, and then the vacuum like Sal is talking about, and then progress to maybe one of the programs.
And MAPS Red is MAPS Anabolic, and that one probably is better than the other programs at getting your metabolism to speed up and amplify. It also has a lower amount of volume, which post-pregnancy, you're not going to want to jump into lots of volume with your training, so that's probably wise. But definitely step one is when you can, when you're cleared, start connecting to your core. You don't need to do crazy exercises, but like practice sucking your stomach in as much as you possibly can. Practice just tensing your core. Practice just doing pelvic tilts. Just get connected to those muscles so that when you do start exercising them, you exercise them properly. And then you can go do your, you know, your normal exercises, your squats, your deadlifts, whatever.
A lot of people don't know this that follow us and listen, that, you know, the way we designed the Mind Pump TV on YouTube, there's playlists. So when you go to the homepage, you look over and there's a tab that says playlist. If you click on the playlist and scroll down, there's categories. And in fact, there's a category that's core, you know, and abs. So I would kind of hang out in the core, especially the core movements, because those are less
rotational movements are going to be really good.
Right. Which will all be in the core stuff, right? That's all going to be in there. The anti-rotational stuff that Justin and I did just recently would be excellent. I would utilize all the free information we have. Then I would eventually probably get the Prime Pro bundle, and then I would move to Max Red.
And not to go off on a tangent, and not to scare anybody who's listening, but the human body or the female body, we've observed, and there's some speculations for some other stuff, but for the most part, you don't add number of fat cells to your body ever, except for a few times in your life. So in other words, if you gain weight or you lose weight, you're not gaining new fat cells, you're just making them bigger or shrinking them. But there are times when you actually add the number of fat cells. One of them is puberty. So when you go through puberty, all of a sudden you get curves or whatever. This has to do with adding actual fat cells. One of the other times is a third trimester of pregnancy. So this is why many women will find after having multiple children that their body changes or they have a tougher time losing weight. Back, yeah. Now, this isn't like a guaranteed like you're screwed. This just is another reason why it's so important to stay active and do proper resistance training before, during, and after pregnancy, because you will find a tremendous difference.
Shout out to our girl Grace Braga right here on this one. Dude.
Oh, Barga, I think her name is.
Barga, right?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. You can go on her Instagram page. You can see what she looked like, 3 weeks after giving birth?
2 weeks, dude. Yeah. She had abs.
Yeah.
2 weeks after having a kid.
And it's not, I'm going to tell you something.
She was straight squatting, deadlifting, and moving
and
all
kept
to
doing
the,
it.
To the day yeah. of.
Yeah. And this is not to make anybody feel bad, because I can only imagine how difficult it must be to stay active during pregnancy. I watched my ex-wife, you know, with the morning sickness, fatigue, like feeling just shit and uncomfortable.
Yeah, it varies how people like what's handed to you through that process.
Yeah, so, I can only imagine. However, I've trained enough people to where I have personally trained countless women before, during, and after pregnancy. And I have seen women who I've trained. So I've had several clients in the recent past. God, just as little as 5 years ago, I've had a couple clients who came to me who said to me, I want to get pregnant, so I want to be extra. I want to be trained properly before the pregnancy. I want you to keep training me during the pregnancy and after the pregnancy. And these aren't like hardcore athletes. These weren't like super competitors or anything. They were regular people. And they bounce back so fast and so effectively. One of them, it was her second child that she hired me for. So her first child, she did it on her own. Mm-hmm. With me, the second one, she was like, it's night and day. She's like, I can't believe how easy it was for me to get lean, how good I felt during the pregnancy. My delivery was amazing. Like, everything just felt easy, so much easier than it was.
You know what, you say that, but I have a bone to pick with the doctors, dude. I mean, I've got my best friend's wife right now, who I've known forever, right? She even listens to the Mind Pump. And she's not right now, I know that, though. And her doctor tells her that, you know, not to lift anything over 20 pounds. And she's a
what are you going
to
do when your baby's over 20 pounds?
She's an active nurse. She's healthy, fit. And, you know, and now part of that, too, I'm sure that she probably led the doctor in that direction, because I feel like people don't want to do anything. It's like, man, I've got a kid now. I'm eating for two. I've got enough on my plate. They're thinking about other things, nursery, all this other shit that's going on. And exercise is just one more thing they're gonna have to do. But it's tough for me, because I've seen it so many times, this happen, and then seeing a best friend's wife going through it now, and I keep thinking to myself, like, man, if she only knew like how much better. And it's like one of those things that even a guy like me, I can't go in and just tell her what to do. It's like,
yeah,
you've got to want to do it.
Well, and then there's also that thing where they think extreme, right? If it's anything like exercise based, like they should be doing things like really like intensively. And, you know, it's a different, like low to moderate intensity, you know, like in frequency, in volume with this is definitely something to highlight. Because I mean, I have, and the thing is too, there's sometimes complications. So you have to like factor that in where it doesn't really make sense to have rigorous movement. Like, but at the same time, like exercise, it will so like the more you can incorporate it, the better you're going to bounce back, the better your pregnancy is going to, it's just like,
it's better for the baby.
It's just better for everything.
It's better for everyone. Yeah. It's something that it's very, very smart. Now, of course, you don't want to get pregnant and then all of a sudden be like, oh, now I'm going to get in shape.
Right.
It doesn't work that way. You want to start before, and then during the pregnancy, you're not training to hit PRs. You're not training to achieve any crazy fitness goals. You're just trained to maintain health, mobility, yeah, strength, and fitness. And it will blow you away. It's so different. I'm telling you right now, it is like a completely different experience when you go into a pregnancy feeling fit and healthy, and you continue that all the way through till after pregnancy. Totally, totally different experience.
And there's some cultures, right, that don't even allow movement through the whole process. It's like hand fit. Yeah,
it's crazy. I think the doctors say what they say because they play the whole...
It's a safety card.
Yep.
Yeah. Oh, of course.
It's all about like
precaution.
I don't want to get sued.
Because you can't be a doctor who says, you should exercise and work out, and they go hurt themselves and they try and sue the doctor.
You know who has the most expensive insurance? What is it called? Malpractice?
Yeah.
OBs.
Yeah.
OBs have the most... I think the average OB spends something like... It's like six figures a year.
Wow.
To pay for their malpractice, because in some states, I believe California is one of them, the mother and the child can sue the OB up until they're 18 years old for something that may have happened during delivery or whatever. So so let's say your kid is
so
like,
no wonder they weigh on that so much.
Of course,
you know what I'm saying?
It's because such a dangerous process.
Right, that's crazy.
Oh yeah, imagine your kid develops like some kind of mental issue or something, and you're like, oh, it's because you said I could lift weights during my pregnancy,
or some heart issue, and she's doing cardio hardcore because you know what I'm saying? So they're always going to weigh on the safety.
They
got
to protect themselves.
God, such bullshit.
Next question is from Aristotle Daphnis. What's your opinion on fish oil as a supplement for general health and well-being?
Good old fish oil.
Fish oil.
You know where a lot of the... That
was popular for a minute, like real popular.
I still use fish oil.
Yeah.
I still...
rub it in your beard?
No.
It looks
no.
nice.
Doesn't I take it for the burps.
Doesn't smell good.
No.
take it for the burps.
Yeah. Yeah, no, that's the worst part about fish oil is the burps afterwards. Yeah. Blech, that's what I hate disgusting.
About it. You know, something to be said about that, by the way. If you're burping up fish oil, you're probably not... assimilating and digesting it well. Yeah. So,
or you're washing it down with a Diet Coke and that's what's causing you to burp and then you taste the fish oil. So it could be more than just the fish oil itself that's not being assimilated, bro. It's not, it doesn't.
Well, I didn't know you were taking it with a fucking Coke.
Well, just be careful. You say that and someone's going to burp after they have a fish oil pill and think that their body's not assimilating it. More than likely,
take fish oil when I smoke.
More than likely,
cigarettes.
Your body assimilates freaking fish oil just fine. And
helps ease it down.
But here's the thing about fish oil, and I can't remember. And this was a big thing that I read like maybe a year or two ago that kind of blew my mind that I didn't know about, because it seems like every chiropractor, doctor, person says, oh, omega-3s, take your fish oil. But what happens is the 3s are competitive with the 6s and 9s, which are like your steaks and so your pro-inflammatory type foods. So, and if you're eating a lot of processed fast food, if you're not eating a very clean, healthy diet, and then you're taking fish oil, you may as well be flushing it down the toilet.
It's the worst Band-Aid of all time.
Right.
I mean, it negates all the positives, right? Because you haven't even eliminated that from your diet yet.
Right. So what happens, and the 6s and 9s are stronger. Think of it like that. So they're both trying to get into the cell. The cell's only so big. The 6s and 9s are stronger. They get in and they fill the cell up. And then you get all the inflammatory markers that start going off, right? So by taking 3, you don't necessarily cancel that. You actually have to have a cleaner, better diet and then also introduce 3, and then you get the real benefits from it. So that being said, absolutely, I still use fish oil occasionally. And the way I use it is I'm just very aware of my fish intake throughout the week, right? I tend to get a lot of sushi and fish, so I don't need to take this a lot. But there are definitely weeks where I don't at all because it's just busy. I didn't make it to my favorite sushi spot. Katrina didn't make fish that week. And so I'm aware of that. So when I tend to string 2 or 3 days in a row, especially if I'm not eating a lot of white meat, I'm eating more red meat, then I'll follow the day up with fish oil because of that. So pay attention to just kind of how your diet is. Now, if you get fish on a pretty regular basis, you probably don't really need it that much. In fact, if you the health benefits that you're getting, which would be the, you know, anti-inflammatory benefits that we're getting from the omega-3s, honestly, just by you reducing these pro-inflammatory foods, like maybe you eat a lot of red meat, maybe you eat a lot of processed foods, taking those out of the diet and switching over to a diet that's lower in sixes and nines is going to make a big difference, more so than even just taking the fish oil.
Here's the thing you want to consider with fish oil. The studies that are done on fish oil that show benefits are done on fish. So they show people who consume this many omega-3s in their diet have these benefits. And then they go, therefore, taking fish oil will give you those benefits. Not the same.
Right.
The studies done on actual fish oil supplements.
Because guess what? The people that are eating fish,
that's it.
They're not eating a bunch of red meat because they're eating a bunch of fish.
That's it. If the studies done on fish oil supplements themselves are mixed at best. So the reality is, if you want the benefits of having omega-3 fatty acids in your diet, then you need to eat fatty fish. Salmon is the obvious example, but like sardines. I've talked about this in the past. Sardines are not anchovies. A lot of people are like, oh, gross. Sardines don't taste like anchovies. They're not super fishy. They're very high in omega-3s. They actually taste pretty good. If you ate like 3 servings a week of them, you get a decent amount of omega-3s, and you're getting them in fish. You're not getting them in just the oil, and you're probably replacing, like Adam said, other types of food. Here's the other thing. If you're going to supplement with fish oil, the fish oil that I would recommend to supplement with would be cod liver oil. The reason why I recommend cod liver oil is because cod liver oil is also very high in the fat-soluble vitamins, vitamin A and vitamin D, both of which tend to be low, especially vitamin D, in the average person's diet. Some studies show as much as 40%.
How many IUs of vitamin D are in there?
I think for every gram, I want to say something like 600. I got to look it up. But it's not like as much as taking a vitamin D supplement.
Right, right. Because I take 5,000 to 10,000 well, IUs a day. Right?
Yeah, but you're taking it.
I have a deficiency.
You might have, yeah. So,
yeah.
But it's a great source of vitamin D. Cultures that don't get lots of sunlight. Look at some of the Nordic countries where there's, you know, the winter is very cold and dark. People consume high amounts of vitamin D from things like cod liver and other types of creatures or whatever that are high in vitamin D. When you look at like the Eskimo type diets, they consume seal blubber and stuff like that is also very high in omega-3. So if you want the benefits of omega-3s, the ideal way to get it is through
real food
that has them. Fish oil is a band-aid at best, and if you're going to go that route, I do really recommend cod liver oil because most of you will benefit from the fat soluble vitamins. I know Weston A. Price, a great website if you're into primal dieting and stuff like that. He's one of the first guys to talk about this stuff. He's like a huge advocate of cod liver oil. Now, that all being said, not all fish oil and cod liver oils is the same. If it goes rancid, which many of them do, many of them are rancid, you're not going to get a lot of the benefits. So make sure you source your fish oil and your cod liver oil very well. Make sure it comes from a good source because just buying it ain't going to do it. Second, one other point, flaxseed oil, which is also high in some of these fatty acids, not nearly the same.
Yeah.
If you supplement with non-animal sources of omega-3s, plant sources, it has to go through a conversion process in the body. So you're limited. You're severely limited by that conversion process. So vegans...
I was going to say, vegans need to pay extra special attention to that.
Yeah, and vegans, this against your beliefs, but you may benefit more from fish oil. Of course, if you don't want any animal products, you can't do that. But if you're open to sometimes supplementing or whatever, plus it's fish, and I know vegans place fish a little lower typically on the totem pole, right?
Yeah, they're ugly.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
We could fucking
they're
kill
not
them.
Cute.
I mean at the end of the day, when it comes to these type of this supplement, the like turmeric, the probiotic, all these types of supplements, like And I think when we first came out with Mind Pump, we were like so anti-supplement. But the reason why we were so anti-supplement
most
was...
Most of them are bad.
Well, yeah, because the most popular ones are bad, right? So the number one like supplement sold right now is pre-workout, which is just a bunch of crap full of stimulants. It's
just fruity crack.
Really, it doesn't... All of us... In fact, I just did a post on the forum. So it's funny we did this question, and I just had a post on the forum sharing with everybody all the different supplements that I use and how regularly I use them. Like, none of them, except for vitamin D, do I use every single day. The rest of them I kind of use based off of what I'm lacking in my diet. If I go on stretches where I haven't had fish, like, this is a good time to probably have some fish oil in my diet. Or an even better option, if I'm not being lazy, because to me the fish oil is my lazy way out, the better thing to do would be go have some fish and or lay off the red meat, because I can easily have a steak for dinner. I could easily have a burger or meat for lunchtime, and then another, you know, red meat for dinner easily in a day or two back to back. I could find myself doing that. So if I do that, then this is where I should change my diet over and get some fishes and white meats in the diet, or add some fish oil the next day.
How often do you guys eat fish?
I eat it every week.
Yeah. I'm probably the worst.
Yeah.
I have to like really focus, like, oh my God, I need this in my rotation, and then we'll have it like once a week or something like that, you know. But I would much prefer land animals all the time if I could.
Yeah. I'm fish at least once, if not two, sometimes three times in a week.
Yeah, same here.
But I could easily also, there's times where I have a week where I don't at all, just because of what I happen to prepare or what Katrina's got going on. So I think that's the real answer is, I have yet to
try to sell me on that.
It's not hard, dude. They don't taste. They're good.
No, I understand you. Like, you make sense. It's just not resonating.
Yeah,
with
me. That one has. I love going down to my favorite sushi place and having some raw sashimi and stuff like that.
I think it's sashimi.
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 Or sashimi.
No, I think it's sashimi.
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 Fuck off, dude.
I swear to God.
I'll say how the fuck
it wouldn't
I
be an episode
say.
If you didn't say something.
It doesn't matter.
So isn't somebody collecting all of them and creating a... I should have close to a book by now.
Adam's library.
Yeah.
Of books.
I mean, Urban Dictionary took off. It's one of the best things. Like, well, can't we have like an Adam Dictionary?
Thesaurus.
Yeah.
Next question is from Alejandro Sanchez Takes Photos. In a perfect world, what would your lives look like?
This is a cool question.
But it looks like now.
Yeah. Exactly. And you know, but let's be honest though, would you have thought that way 10 years ago? And here's what I think of, like, we're in the middle of, like, we all have goals, right? So we're driving towards these goals, and someone would think, oh, when you reach those, that would be what the perfect life looks like. So, like, for example, let's use the business right now. You know, I would love, when I feel like we have really, really made it is when we have 50 to 100 employees, that we have provided a very realistic, serious, good income and living for. Yeah. To me, that is going to be a huge day for me when we have reached that point where we're providing that many jobs for people and doing something that they love to do and making good money doing it. So, but I also recognize that part of loving life is loving that process of getting there. Mm-hmm. And if you don't learn to love where you're at right now and love your life now, real soon you'll find out that no matter how many goals and records and things that you accomplish and crush, you'll still feel empty afterwards. Mm-hmm. Because it's all about perspective, and it's all about you learning to enjoy the process and the journey. I mean, this is the alchemist, right? So understand that
What's his name? Miguel?
Paul Coelho.
Oh, Coelho, there you go.
That's the author, if that's what you're asking.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's authors, yeah. But yeah, that's a great read in regards to this. I felt like when I actually finally read that book, I had kind of put this together, because something happened to me in my, you know, early 20s to mid 20s where, you know, I was a kid who came up from like nothing, and I felt like it was a financial status that I needed to get to that then I would love my life. Like, I have my toys, I have my house, I can travel, I can do things. And to me, that was like the ultimate life. Like, when I could, and I was working, I put my head down since I was a teenager until I got there. And then I arrived, and sure, there's lots, and don't get me wrong, there was lots of things that I was like, man, this is nice, I can do this, I can do that. But I didn't love myself or love my life any more than I did during the grind and the struggle to get there.
It wasn't any more fulfilling.
No. And so I think where we're all at in our lives now is understanding that fucking life is good, man.
I'll tell you what, something that I learned relatively recently, and really it's something that I knew, but I didn't really know until relatively recently, was that when I feel like my life is perfect and everything's great, it's because I have purpose. It's not so much even what I'm doing. It's not how much I'm working or how much I'm on vacation or all that stuff. It's when I feel like I have purpose, I feel like my life is fulfilling. There's lots of examples of this. I use this all the time. You know, we look at, you know, we talk about people who work really hard and, you know, it's like there's too much work and it's too much of a grind. You know, I'll tell you what, some of the hardest working people you'll ever find in your entire life are people who volunteer. People who volunteer for causes that they truly believe in. People who volunteer for like Peace Corps or people who truly have a purpose and want to feed the homeless or want to build shelters or whatever. And they work long hours. They grind it out. They don't get paid very much. But you'll talk to them and many of them are truly happy with what they're doing because it's backed up, motivated, pushed by whatever you want to call it, by their purpose. And that's true for me as well. When I'm doing what I'm doing and I feel like there's a greater purpose, when I'm doing it for something bigger than just, you know, I want to make some money or this is my job or, you know, yeah, I'm supposed to hang out with my kids or whatever. When it's this grander purpose, everything changes. All of a sudden, everything I do becomes much more fulfilling because I feel like I'm choosing it. Mm. Number one, like I'm choosing to do this because it's fulfilling my purpose. I also feel like it's bigger than me. That's a great feeling, by the way. When you're doing something and you feel like it's bigger than you are, mm-hmm. you'll find more motivation, you'll find more drive, you'll find more creativity, better performance than you've ever found in your life. It's an incredible feeling. My dad is a great example of this. My father worked, he's poor. He grew up very, very poor in Sicily. You know, was it lots of siblings, parents couldn't afford much. You know, he slept in a bed with his, you know, three brothers and his sister slept in another bed. And I think he was like that until he moved out when he was 18. Working since he was 9. And when I mean working, I mean literally went to work, busting his ass to make money that give to his mom so that she could feed everybody. Has always been this way. Came to this country, did the same thing, worked 7 days a week for as long as I knew my dad, but always made it home for dinner, always spent time with the kids. So it was a great dad. But his purpose was, my purpose is I want to support my family. I want to see my kids do well. And, you know, as hard as it was, and sometimes he would talk about how hard he worked, everything was good. Then, because of this hard labor, he was unable to do it for super long. He had arthritis up and down his back, and his knees were bad, and he had to retire. And as he retired, now he's at home. He's got pension. He built this middle class life. He's comfortable. He's not by any means wealthy, but he's comfortable. And he went through a long period of depression going through this because even though he didn't grind it out, he wasn't doing all this crazy stuff. He had all the time in the world to ride his motorcycle and do whatever. He found himself without purpose, and it was a very difficult position for him to be in. And we had a lot of conversations where he's like, "Man," he goes, "I never thought that not working would suck." Yeah. He's like, it's very strange. And he loved his job. He loved what he did.
Dude, I put this together with all the clients that I train. And people ask all the time, like, have you ever thought about your retirement? I'm like, dude, I don't have no plans to retire. Yeah. No plans. Mm-hmm. I hope that I really...
It's just a slow death.
And that might sound crazy, but I hope that I literally fall over dead working. Like, I don't want to stop working.
As long as even if I ever stop, quote unquote, working for money, I guarantee you there's going to be some other purpose, whether it be learning
and
or
that's
teaching
what I,
or whatever.
And that's what I try and explain to people. It doesn't necessarily, I don't mean I want to work to like get by and like I don't want to work till I'm 90 to just make sure I pay the bills, but I always want to have something I'm working towards because, and we see this, man, and recently this has happened in my life where I've had people pass and to watch the partner. It's crazy when you see it like firsthand right in front of you. Where you watch someone who's 60, 70 years old or whatever, and they lose their husband or spouse, right? and they look like they age 20 years. Yeah.
Within it happens really fast.
Like a year. Yeah,
the decline.
1 year. Yeah. And this is like firsthand me seeing
the
this.
Posture, then the health. And,
everything. Yeah,
the disconnect from all the community.
And yeah. and I'm not saying that to like, you know, people that go through that. I mean, it's got to be one of the hardest things in the world to have a partner that you've had for 30, 40, 50 years of your life and then lose them. That's got to be one of the toughest things to push through. But so many people, once they do that, they completely lose that drive for themselves to stay alive. And you can see, and it's such a psychological thing that turns into a physical thing like overnight, all of a sudden you see this person who looks full of life and mm-hmm. vibrant sucked
dude,
out within
dude,
a year.
Dude, you have to change. Your purpose has to change too with your life. Like, yeah. You know, I know people in my family women who identified very strongly with being mothers, and their purpose was all about their kids. Then the kids move out of the house, mm-hmm. go off to school, or whatever, and it's like 3 years
well,
of like,
you have to
what the fuck do I do?
Your own identity through mm-hmm. the whole process, and I think that like thinking about that way ahead of time is going to be very beneficial. And that's something that I'm always making sure like I'm finding purpose in everything I'm doing. And I think that like this question, it's like, well, you could put a different vision in my head of like what might be more ideal or more perfect. But like Adam said, it's understanding like how to enjoy the process, the day-to-day things that I can win every day. I can get better at. I can improve. I find a lot of a pleasure out of like visibly and seeing results personally in things that I take on, and then you know, also how I'm able to kind of become something different. And that's something that always drives me like personally, but really it's for me, it's always been about like affecting other people. And if I can work and do anything in life to impact somebody else, like that's where I'm at. I want to always be in that space. So that's very important to me. That's what's like in a perfect world for me.
Next up is literally Annika. Heard you guys talk about meditation a few times. Can you talk about how you individually practice it? Do you use apps? Do you use music? Do you use specific exercises or breathing patterns?
Literally Annika has got a great Instagram page, by the way. She's actually one of our listeners, and she does...
Obviously, she's a listener.
talk about living your life, living your perfect Instagram. Life. You know what she does for a living? Travels. She works for these like cruise ships, and she posts about them, and she's traveling. If you look at her page, that's all she does.
Wow, that's cool.
I'm like, that's awesome. So meditation. For me, meditation, of all the things that I do for my health and wellness and mindset, that's the thing that I tend to neglect the most. It's still mm-hmm. so difficult for me to take 5 minutes to sit down and meditate. It's just a very difficult thing. It's not instinctual with me yet. It's still something I have to consciously kind of, you know, be aware of and say, okay, I got to do this. Whereas my workout just happens, nutrition just happens for me. You know, that being said, when I do it, if I only have 5 or 10 minutes, brain.fm.
Fuck yes.
You know, we met the guys.
There's a direct
just a helpful tool.
Doug put the direct link up on the Mind Pump Media page again. Right, Doug?
Yeah.
What, do they get a discount, Doug, still?
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a discount. And if you just go to brain.fm/mindpump, you can get that discount.
Okay, cool. So brain.fm has these sounds and stuff that you listen to that have been proven to promote the brain wave patterns that they've observed in people who meditate. So when a mind is in meditation, or a mind is in sleep, or a mind is in focus, or a mind is in, you know, rest or whatever, there are signature brainwave patterns that we can observe. In fact, they can actually observe your brain, and they can pretty accurately predict whether or not you're meditating or awake and focused on something or whatever. So brain.fm, you put these headphones on, you listen to these sounds, and it helps promote the state. Now, you can get into the state of meditation without brain.fm, but here's what I found. It takes me a lot longer. If I sit there and I try to meditate for 10 minutes and I only have 10 minutes to meditate, which is typically how long I'll give myself, it's like 8 minutes in, and then I start to get into it and then I got to get out of it. Whereas with Brain FM, it's more like 2 or 3 minutes and I'm in it. Also, that being said, I know my girlfriend listening right now would correct me if she was in the room. Meditation is about one truly aware moment. It is not about time. It's about sequence of moments, because time is, you know, it doesn't work that way. It's all present. So it's just like one moment of actual presence. Now you've meditated, and you can have several of those moments,
which can take 1 minute or 40 minutes, right? Depending on the person and how good you are at getting into this state. And I'm going to definitely piggyback off of what Sal said. Brain FM, and by the way, we're not sponsored by Brain FM. It's we provide the discount code. We had them on the show. We love the guys. This is something.
We still use it.
Yeah. It's if there is anything out of all people that we've connected with that have like handed us tools, and I messed around with the Jove Light for a while, and I kind of intermittently, you still use that every now and then to play around with it. And we've had all kinds of shit sent our way. Nothing have I used more consistently than Brain.fm. Now, the reason why that is because it was such a game changer for me. It may not be for somebody else. Maybe you're somebody who has that it's easy for you to meditate. Maybe you can just get into that state, no problem. You already practiced. Then it's probably not for you. Someone like me who, A, struggled with falling asleep at night, and then B, had a really hard time trying to settle his mind down to meditate. It's been a game changer. Now, that being said, I also try to not use it, right? So I don't want it to become a crutch where I can only get to sleep or I can only meditate if I have this tool in my ear. But I do use it to help me get in that state when I know that I'm in like this elevated state already.
You're traveling or you're in a different environment or something. Yeah, you have all kinds of other variables. That's typically how I'll use it as well. And I like that you can sort of control that it's only so long. Like if it's a short bout that I need to just kind of focus on, I will use Brain FM. What I've found for me, like ever since doing the Wim Hof, I will try and plan out at least two times a week. And I've fallen short a couple weeks, but I've been pretty consistent with at least once a week where I'll do a good 20, 30 minute session where I'm doing a Wim Hof, where there's a nice playlist on Spotify. If you just search Wim Hof, and it has a bunch of different soundtracks that you can kind of go and do these breathing patterns to kind of go through that tempo. So that's been really helpful for me, man.
Also to piggyback off of you, the box breathing is something. So when I am getting into that state where I want to meditate for a while or settle down, right, become more present. Like, to me, I don't even really call it meditation. I just call it me becoming more present, because I know that it's hardest for me when we have guests and we've been going, like Justin was saying, we're flying all over the place. I'm like,
the last 7 days has been insane.
My brain is just on fire, and I can't sleep at night, and it's just all this stuff is being processed, and I'm not being present. I'm thinking about all the things I need to do, what we just did, all this information I just consumed, and I'm not even being present right now. And I know when it's happening, and obviously when I go to sleep, it's very obvious then. But I mean, Katrina can always read the energy on me as soon as I walk in the door. She can just tell that I'm like not there, you know, and she'll call me out on it. Just, you know, I can tell you're not here yet. And I'm like, yeah, no, I just a lot going on right now, this and that. And she'll kind of, you know, go Brain FM or go meditate or go read for a little bit. Become more present is what it is. And I don't even have to get to 10 box breaths. If I do sit down and box breathe, which is, you know, 5-5-5, which I'm just five, I'm taking in through my stomach, real deep inhale, hold for 5 seconds, release for 5 seconds slow. I can't even get to 10, and I could totally feel my heart rate drop literally, like almost feel like it cuts in half. Like all of a sudden, whoo.
Yeah, it's very physical.
Oh, very, very much so.
When you're focused like that.
Very, and sometimes I don't even get to 10. Like by five, I'm already like that.
Here's the other thing too with meditation is, like exercise or like any other practice, there are some acute benefits you get from it. In other words, if you've never meditated and you meditate once, you'll notice that you're more relaxed and you feel better. But the real benefits, just like with exercise, don't happen until you're consistent with it over a period of time. So, and it's important to know this, because I was one of these people where I would do it, you know, once or twice and be like, I got something out of it, but it's not that big of a deal. And so I kind of wrote it off. If you stick with it and you're consistent, and just start with this, literally start with 3 to 5 minutes a day. That's it. Very, very short. 3 to 5 minutes every single day, whether it's in the morning, at night, before you go to bed. However, Do that consistently and watch what happens after about 2 or 3 weeks. After about 2 or 3 weeks of just being consistent with your 3 minutes of meditation, just like with exercise, you're going to start to notice some interesting things happening with your body and your mind. One of the first things you'll notice is you just remember stuff. You're making space and you just have a better memory.
I was just going to say something right now that I wish I had this tool and resource when I was going through school. I wish I understood this. And I would love somebody to reach out that's like a college student or somebody that like is cramming and that has take this. This is what I would do. Like if I knew like I had a final coming up or a big paper I have to write, I would totally do a 15-minute like Brain FM meditation session and then get into my studying afterwards. And I bet you will see a huge difference in the amount of information that you retain and you hold because you just clear your mind. Mm-hmm. That's really what, like you said, you become so present, you stop all the other shit. If you were sitting still trying to meditate and all the shit, stress, and everything's flying through your head, you're not there yet. Mm-hmm. You need to practice it until you can get there because it will.
It's a skill.
Yeah.
It's a skill like anything.
And here's the deal. Those of you that try it, struggle with it, are the ones that need it the most. Those of you that do it fall right into it. Not as much of a big deal because you have the ability to do it. So that should be a flag for you if you've tried it and you failed. That's not your reason to give up on it. That's your body and telling you you need this. You're not good at it. You have a hard time becoming present. And don't just disregard it because you can't do it or you have a hard time. That should be your sign that, listen, this isn't an issue for me. I have a hard time becoming present. You're the person, okay, that needs it more than anybody else.
Mm-hmm. Check it out. If you like Mind Pump the podcast, then you're going to love Mind Pump TV on YouTube. It's different content. It's not just the podcast on YouTube. It's literally different. It's more free fitness information. It's exercise demos. It's discussions on nutrition.
Vlogs, entertainment. Vlogs. What's in my bag?
It's all there. Mind Pump TV. Go to YouTube. Subscribe to the channel. We're one of the only fitness channels in existence that posts 365 videos a year. Yes, we are crazy. Also, if you go to mindpumpmedia.com, you can enroll in 30 days of coaching for absolutely free.
Thank you for listening to Mind Pump. If your goal is to build and shape your body, dramatically improve your health and energy, and maximize your overall performance, check out our discounted RGB Super Bundle at mindpumpmedia.com. The RGB Super Bundle includes MAPS Anabolic, MAPS Performance, and MAPS Aesthetic, 9 months of phased expert exercise programming designed by Sal, Adam, and Justin to systematically transform the way your body looks, feels, and performs. With detailed workout blueprints and over 200 videos, the RGB Super Bundle is like having Sal, Adam, and Justin as your own personal trainers, but at a fraction of the price. The RGB Super Bundle has a full 30-day money-back guarantee, and you can get it now plus other valuable free resources at mindpumpmedia.com. If you enjoy this show, please share the love by leaving us a 5-star rating and review on iTunes and by introducing Mind Pump to your friends and family. We thank you for your support, and until next time, this is Mind Pump.